Hi, welcome back. As kids growing up, probably you might have seen this type of insect forms. What are these? These are dragonflies. Probably you might have entered to the midst of these swarms and you might have tried to collect one or two dragonflies and you might have enjoyed that moment. So why these dragonflies forms this many number, especially in some conditions, some situations, under usually near the surface of trees? What are the characteristics feature of these dragonflies? When we talk about dragonflies, one more group which come to our mind are damselflies, and also one more close ally are mayflies. Okay, so these are dragonflies and this is damselflies and these are mayflies. Okay, so in this class we will study the general characters of two Paleopteran orders, which includes Epimeraptera, which are nothing but mayflies, and Odonata, which are nothing but dragon and damselflies. Okay, so we are going to study the general characters of these two orders, which are commonly called Paleopteran orders. So in the previous systematics classes, I was telling that I'm keep on putting this slide till the end of this systematics lecture series, with the sole intention that this classification will be clearly understood to you. So superclass or epiclass Hexapoda is divided into two unranked groups called Entognathus Hexapoda and Ectognathus Hexapoda. So Entognathus Hexapoda consists of two class, class Ellipura, which consists of two orders, Protura and Columbola, and then class Diplura, which consists of order Diplura, and then two class Insecta, which are nothing but the Ectognathus Hexapoda. So this class Insecta is divided into two subclasses, subclass Archaeognatha and subclass Dicondylia. So subclass Archaeognatha consists of one order Archaeognatha, which is also called Microcrypha, whereas subclass Dicondylia consists of infraclass Thysanura, also called Zygentoma, and infraclass Pterygota. Okay, so infraclass Pterygota consists of two divisions, division Paleoptera and division Neoptera. So in fact, in the previous insect systematics lectures, we studied the general characters of these five orders, which includes three non-insect and hexapodan orders and two Pterygotan true insect orders. Okay, so now we are concentrating on infraclass Pterygota. In this class, I'll be talking about division Paleoptera, which consists of two orders, order Epimeraptera and order Odonata. Okay, so what is the, how do you distinguish this division Paleoptera and division Neoptera? So Paleo means, etymologically, means old, ancient. Okay, Pteran means wings. They are winged insects, of course, but they do not have the ability to bend the wings above the abdomen at rest. Okay, so say for example, dragonflies will be beating their wings like this, horizontally they're keeping, and they don't have the ability to bend the wings above the abdomen at rest, behind the back of their body. Okay, so whereas the other insects, all the other winged insects, have the ability to bend the wings above the abdomen at rest. So that is the difference between Paleoptera and Neoptera. So you can see here. So in this class, I will be concentrating on two orders, the general characters of two orders, Epimeraptera and Odonata. So Paleoptera means, you can see here, dragonflies will beat the wings like this during flight, but when they alight, when they sit, okay, they place their wings horizontally like this only, but they don't have the ability to place their wings above the abdomen at rest. They cannot bring the wings above the abdomen at rest. So these are the only two orders which lacks that mechanism. Whereas all the other winged insects have the ability to bend the wings above the abdomen at rest. Hence they are called Neopterans. So they are advanced group of insects. So they may be, bugs, beetles, okay, moths, butterflies, or any of such kind. Okay, so you can see here, they can bend the wings above the abdomen at rest. You can see these beetles also. Okay, it can. So that is the difference between the Paleoptera and division Neoptera. So we'll take one by one. So order Epimeraptera, they are commonly called mayflies. So etymologically, Epimera means short living, Pteran means wings. So why this name short living? So in fact, adult mayflies live for a very short period. So maybe about 6 to 10 hours to a day, maximum of a week, depending on different species. So maximum they can survive for about a week. But as naiads, as young ones, they live in water, but they spend years, okay, very long period in aquatic ecosystem. Okay, but the name is actually derived because of the adult lifespan, which is very short. Okay, that's why they are called mayflies. So let us see the some of the important characteristic feature of this order, Epimeraptera. So they are soft-bodied insects. They are many of them are very small to medium-sized insects. So they may measure about half a centimeter to 1 centimeter to maximum of 2 to 3 centimeter. And they have got very short cetaceous antennae, and mouth parts are vestigial. Okay, so in fact they do not feed during the adult stage. So the long duration of NAD stage is they feed a lot, and that is sufficient for a short survival period of adult. Okay, so and they have basically they have got biting and chewing type of mouth parts, but it is usually vestigial, okay, non-functional. Okay, so other important characters includes wings are membranous, okay, and yield vertically upwards when at rest. Okay, so you can see here they are placed above the abdomen at rest like this, so upwards, vertically placed like this. Don't get confused, they don't bend the wings above the abdomen like this. They are kept like this above the vertically upwards when at rest, and they are never folded. Hind pairs considerably reduced, so they are very small compared to the forewings. You can see here hind wings are comparatively reduced, and in some species they may be absent. So hind wings may be absent, and numerous cross vines will be present. You can see here large number of longitudinal vines and cross vines. So number of cross vines will be present. Abdomen terminated by a very long sarsi. You can see here 2 sarsi which are very long, and in some species the median or the caudal median filament may be present or it may be absent. Okay, that means abdomen terminated by a very long sarsi with or without a similar median process. So only you may find 2 sarsi or sometime both the sarsi and a median caudal filament. Okay, so those are a few other characters. Coming to growth and development. Okay, so eggs are deposited in water. So primarily their life is found in aquatic ecosystem. So eggs are deposited in water. You can see here they lay large number of eggs, up to 4000 eggs by few species, and metamorphosis is hemimetabolous. That means there will be 3 stages: egg, naiad and adult. There will not be any pupal stage. So they are hemimetabolous insects. Nymphs are aquatic. So that means once the eggs are deposited in the aquatic ecosystem like this, it hatches into naiads, and they are campodiform. So they are meant for predaceous purpose primarily, but many of them feed on the rich algal slime, which usually grows on the surface, say on the various stones or various other submerged stones which are present in the aquatic ecosystem, where they survive by feeding on the algal material. And whereas few species are predaceous, so usually they are found on the surface of submerged stones. You can see a large number of more number of eggs are deposited by a single female. So usually find very large number of naiads in aquatic ecosystem wherever they are there. So and additionally, in fact, they act as food for other organisms which are present in the aquatic system, maybe fishes. So very important ecosystem service they are providing, because they act as food for fishes. Okay, so and usually with a long sarsi. Okay, there will be sarsi in the naiad stage also, and also there will be median caudal filament in the naiad stage. And basically for respiration, in fact they have got gills. So abdominal segment 1 to 7 with a lamellate tracheal gills. So whatever the gills which are present, they are called lamellate tracheal gills, helpful in taking up the oxygen present in the aquatic ecosystem, so from the water directly. So that is the growth and development. Coming to life cycle, as I was telling, the eggs are deposited in very large number, and they may be usually submerged in water in aquatic ecosystem, and they hatch into naiads. So thereby, in fact, as naiads, they may act as food for various frog species or say fishes. And the one which actually escape predation by these aquatic invertebrates or vertebrates, and then they come to the surface, they molt. Okay, they molt from the naiad stage, they molt to an adult stage which is called sub-imago, not exactly adult stage, which is called imago means adult, sub-imago means a pre-adult stage. We can say it is not a complete adult. Okay, so this is emerging adult, which is called done sometime, and usually they alight on vegetation or the shore in the aquatic system. And they molt once again, Okay, they molt once again, they are called spinners. Okay, so then they mate actually, both males and females mate, and they again go near the surface of the water, and then they deposit the eggs like this, which actually falls on the, goes deep into the water bodies. So that's how they spend most of their life in the aquatic system itself, and only for a short period they come out on the surface of water, they mate, and they again lays the eggs. So adults are very short-lived. So I'll repeat this. When ready to transform as winged stage, the naiads rises to the surface of water and molts. And the winged form flies to a short distance to the shore and usually alights on vegetation. Okay, so usually there's no rest there. This is not the complete adult and is called dunce, technically called subimago. Okay, so this subimago molts once again, more usually next day to become adult spinners. Okay, that reaches to sexually mature imago stage. That means subimago are not sexually mature, whereas imago are sexually mature. So very important thing you need to remember here is that, so there will be a molting even in the adult stage. Okay, no other winged insect molts during winged stage. Remember, only some of the apterous insects, unwinged insects, molts even in the adult stage, whereas Epimeraptor or mayflies are the only insect groups where adult actually molts. So that's why two stages are recognized in the adult stage. One is called subimago, which are not sexually mature, and also there will be a clear cut difference. In fact, there will be a lot of hairs on its body that is not shiny, whereas the imago is actually shiny, and they will be devoid of any hairs on its body because it actually goes with a molted skin. Okay, so remember this point. There will be naiads molt into subimago stage, and from subimago they become imago. So the subimago is dull and somewhat plumaged, whereas the imago is bare. Okay, imago is shiny and smooth. So that's how you can differentiate the subimago and imago stage. Okay, you can see here naiad is molting. Okay, you can see the tracheal gills. It molts. You can see here. Yeah, it becomes subimago. So that subimago stage, you can see here, that subimago is alighting on the vegetation somewhere on the seashores or somewhere. It's molting once again. Subimago becomes imago now. So that's how it molts and flies off, mates, and comes back to the water surface in order to lay the eggs. So that's how they complete the life cycle. Remember, the mayflies are the only insects that molts once again after the wings become functional. No other winged insects has this ability. Okay, so you can see here naiad is actually molting, and this is the molted skin. This is the subimago stage. So then the subimago become imago. So this is the only character found in case of Epimeraptor or mayflies. So when they emerge in large number, so usually near the water bodies especially, large dams and all, so millions of these mayflies emerge. Okay, and you can see here, so they may become nuisance. Okay, so practically darkening the roads, blacking the roads. That's how they become nuisance. Otherwise, in the aquatic ecosystem, they act as food for fishes and other organisms. As a result of that, they form a very important component in food web. Okay, so some of the visuals you can see here, beginners can easily recognize these mayflies, especially near the water bodies. They come to the light, they can be collected, but they are very delicate, in fact. So properly they need to be collected and killed. So a few of the examples includes Cleon bicolor, BT species. Okay, approximately around the world, 3,124 species have been described, and in India, 124 species. Okay, so coming to the next order Odonata, which includes both dragonflies and damselflies. So etymologically, the Odonata is derived from odos, means toothed, named after toothed mouth parts. Okay, so mandibles and maxillae especially has got denticles like structures. That's why. And with the help of that, they are able to feed the prey which is collected with the help of legs. I'll come to that later. So the important characters of Odonata are predaceous insects with biting mouth parts. Okay, you can see these are the biting mouth parts, and antennae are filiform and prominent, very clear. Okay, they are filiform antenna placed above the mouth parts between the eyes. And eyes are very large and prominent, you can see here. So there will be a large number of ommatidia, in fact. So that's why they are actually very good flyers. So eyes are very large, then very clear in fact. So other character includes two equal or sub-equal pairs of elongated membranous wings. So wings are membranous, but you can see here, they may be equal or sub-equal. Equal means perfectly equal, or sub-equal means nearly equal. So you can see here in this case of dragonflies, they are nearly equal. Okay, they are not exactly, no, both the forewings and hindwings are not same sized. So that's why they are sub-equal. So dragonflies have got sub-equal wings, whereas the damselflies have exactly the same sized wings. So that is the difference between the dragonflies and damselflies. It is in fact one of the difference. So and also they have got these, whether it may be a dragonflies or a damselfly, the wings possess pterostigma and a nodus. Okay, a cross vein in fact. So that's how we can recognize from other insect groups where you may find the pterostigma, but you may not find the nodus. Okay. Other characters includes abdomen elongate, very long in fact. And in case of males, genitalia is found in case of abdominal sterna in the ventral side in the second abdominal segment. This is the only exception, remember. Okay. In all other insects, male genitalia is found in the ninth abdominal segment. As a result of that, you can see here, this is the male wherein you find the genitalia in the second abdominal segment. With the help of claspers, which are present in the last abdominal segment, which holds the female. And female will bend the body in such a way that it brings its genitalia towards the second abdominal segment of male and then mate. Okay, so in fact, lot of territorial behavior and copulatory behavior is there. So interested students can go through that further. Very interesting features, in fact, these both dragonflies and damselflies. This is how they mate. So this is the mating posture. So coming to naiad characteristics, so they are hemimetabolous. So that means there will be a naiad stage. Naiads are aquatic. Either respire through three caudal gills. Okay, if the caudal gills are found, cauda means last abdominal segment, they are damselflies. If you do not find any gills externally, they possess gills inside, they are rectal gills. So rectum is precisely a part of digestive system, you know. So their gills are attached, that's why they are called rectal gills. Okay, so caudal gills are found in case of damselflies, whereas rectal gills are found in case of dragonflies, remember. So naiad's labium of naiad is in fact is placed like this. Okay, it will be placed like this and is modified into a prehensile organ. Okay, prehensile means it's modified for raptorial purpose. Raptorial means predation purpose. So that means naiads of dragon and damselflies are predaceous. Okay, so is modified into a prehensile organ or mask. Why it is called mask? In fact, when it is not in use, when it is the labium, for example, it will be placed like this. Okay, and when it is ready for predation, whenever it finds other insects or other, say, small creatures in the aquatic ecosystem, it captures it and it devours. Okay, so that's why this labium is a very important organ for predation purpose in case of naiads of dragon and damselflies. So coming to distinguishing features of these two, damselflies and dragonflies groups. In fact, this order Odonata is divided into two suborders, Anisoptera and Zygoptera. So Anisoptera are nothing but the dragonflies and Zygoptera means damselflies. Remember students, so far, I have not entered into the suborder level. This is the first time I am entering to suborder level. In all those 5 or 6 orders we studied so far, okay, we didn't enter into the suborder level classification. Okay, so this is the first time we are now studying, and in the future orders we may get into the family characters as well. So how do you distinguish dragon and damselflies? So Anisoptera, dragonflies, which consists of 4 wings and hind wings, are unequal in size. I was telling previously, if you know the order level character, it is very easy to distinguish dragonflies and damselflies. They are unequal in size. So we can say that they are sub-equal. Whereas in case of damselflies, 4 wings and hind wings are approximately of the same size and shape. Okay. Hind wings are broad at base. You can see here, hind wings are broad at base. This is the reason why they are actually not sub-equal. Hind wings are broad at base. Whereas here, both the pairs of wings are narrow at base. You can see they are narrow. Wings are held horizontally at rest. This will be placed like this, okay, at rest. Whereas in case of damselflies, they are placed above the abdomen, okay, held vertically above the thorax and abdomen. That's how we can distinguish, even in the sitting posture, we can distinguish dragon and damselflies, okay. Other characters includes eyes are contiguous. They are touching each other. Okay, you can see here. Another one of the order which have already come across this character. What is that? Now try to think over. If you are not remembering, go back to previous class, previous lecture, and try to listen once again. Whereas in case of damselflies, eyes are not contiguous. They are separate. So dragonflies are very strong and agile flyers, whereas damselflies are comparatively weak flyers. Okay. Coming to the distinguishing characters in case of naiads. Even in the naiads, if you collect in the aquatic ecosystem, you can distinguish. So naiads of dragonflies are stout and robust bodied. You can see here. They are strong. Whereas damselfly naiads are slender and fragile bodied. Okay, they are their body is actually tapered. Gills not visible externally. That's why they are called rectal gills, whereas they possess caudal gills which are found in the last abdominal segment. That's why they are called caudal gills. So caudal gills are visible, they are damselfly naiads, whereas the gills are not visible, they are rectal gills, they are anisoptrans. That's how we can distinguish these two orders, both in the naiad stage as well in the adult stage. Coming to life cycle of odonates. So adults look for the aquatic water bodies, and they may pierce the eggs into the vegetation, or sometimes they may just pour the eggs, or though they leave the eggs on the surface of the water, and they usually get submerged in the aquatic ecosystem, and they hatch into naiads, and they survive by feeding on the various other creatures present in the water bodies. They molt 2-3 times depending on the species, and the matured naiad come to the surface near the water surface, and they molt into adult. Okay, so that's how they complete the life cycle in aquatic ecosystem. So usually the life history of odonates is closely linked with water bodies, because naiads require water. Without that, they don't survive. They use wide range of flowing and stagnant water. So different species have the ability to survive at different habitats. They may be flowing water, it may be stagnant water. They feed on the aquatic insects, especially mosquito larvae. During naiad stage, they feed on mosquito larvae. So very important, right? So probably you just imagine if dragon and damselflies are not there. Okay, mosquito population would have enhanced, doubled. Okay, so they actually keep the population under check. Okay, they also prey on small fishes and tadpoles as well. So most species of odonates are highly specific to habitat. So different species may survive in flowing water, or some of the species may survive in stagnant water. They are specific to habitat. However, some have adapted to urban areas and make use of man-made water bodies. So for example, urban areas, say, just think of a water container placed on the terrace, or say for example small ponds where they may dry up soon. They are actually ephemeral water sources. They actually utilize the such ephemeral habitats and they breed there. Okay, so that's why many of the species also found in urban ecosystem. So adult dragonflies and damselflies are aerial predators. Okay, as naiads, they survive by feeding on the various other creatures in the water body itself, whereas adults, they are aerial predators. They are able to capture the prey on flight. Okay, they catch insects like mosquitoes, midges, butterflies, moths, psyllids, and bees on flight. While flying itself, they capture. You can see that they go behind small insects and they capture with the help of modified legs. In fact, their legs are highly modified in order to capture the prey. So you can see here, once they capture, usually they feed there itself, or sometimes they alight somewhere, rest somewhere, then they start feeding whatever the prey they have collected. Okay, so that's how usually they found near the tree surface in large number, and they prey on. So they feed in flight. Okay, they capture on flight, they feed in flight using the legs to capture the prey, and the legs are highly specialized. In fact, legs are specialized. They are actually modified like basket. Okay, they are called basket type of legs and modified in order to capture the prey and devour. Okay, so you might have seen this type of swarms on the tree surface. Usually, so during some hours of the day, the large number of insects which are found feeding on these trees, they may come out. And during that time, so swarms of dragonflies comes there and they try to capture those small insects and they devour. So that's why usually you'll find the dragon and damselflies flying around near the tree surfaces. Okay, these are the some visuals you can see. They are very beautiful, in fact, very beautiful creatures. You can see the sitting posture, you can identify the dragon and damselflies. So these two are dragonflies, these two are dragonflies, and these three are damselflies. So very colorful creatures, in fact. So approximately 6,042 species have been described worldwide, and in India, 463 species. Okay, so collection and preservation. So naiads, as I told, they are found in aquatic ecosystem. They have to be directly collected and transferred to the 70% to 80% ethyl alcohol. Okay. Whereas adults, they are usually found near water bodies, swarms, and tree surface. So once they are collected, they needs to be properly, the appendages needs to be properly spread, and you can keep a paper strip, a butter paper strip, and kept for drying for about 24 hours or so, and they needs to be labeled. Okay, so it is compulsory to label whatever the insects which you collect, and they can be stored in cabinet racks after drying. Okay, I want to end the lecture with few questions. What is the difference between imago and subimago in case of mayflies? Type of legs in case of odonata? What is labial mask in case of naiads of odonata? What are the caudal gills and rectal gills? How do you distinguish? What is bronchial chamber in Anisoptera in case of dragonflies? So probably you can answer all these four questions, first four questions, with the contents you go through this presentation. Whereas for this last question, you may have to refer some textbooks. So thank you very much. If there are any questions, you can post below or you can email me as well. Thank you very much.